Part 3, Chapter 3, The Dam at Work Method. In comparison to the dam online method outlined in the previous chapter, the dam at work method relies less on mass media and more on leveraging workplace allegations and work-related authorities. And while it's not quite as easy as posting allegations across the internet, the amount of effort required or remarkably destructive results is still surprisingly small. I'll illustrate with the following vignette. Kathy Cleek was a new hire, a recent graduate with a master's degree in marketing. She was happy to finally leave the academic world and hit the ground running at her first real job. Socially outgoing and chatty, Kathy related to her college colleagues as though they were personal friends. She started a company bowling team, went to happy hour with coworkers, and was devilishly excited to engage in office gossip. Now, upper management liked her energy, initiative, and personality. It wasn't long before she developed a close-knit group of followers at work. Eric, introvert, however, tended to keep to himself, true to the many stereotypes about engineers. He was more comfortable working with data and things than with people. A longtime employee of the company, he had worked his way up to over the years from an entry-level position to senior engineer. It didn't take Kathy long to discover that she disliked Eric. He was reserved, had few friends, and did not participate in company social activities. Likewise, he consistently declined Kathy's invitations to join the bowling team and other such things. Worse, when she expressed new ideas about how to market the company's products, he often criticized her for overselling the product's technical capabilities. In sum, Eric got in her way and made her look bad. So, true to her nature, Kathy began to communicate her dismay to her large circle of friends at work. She complained that Eric stifled her ideas by interrupting and criticizing her during meetings. She said Eric discounted her perspective because she was female. To be supportive, her work friends echoed her sentiments and reinforced her negative views of Eric. Empowered, Kathy then took complaints to human resources. She stated that Eric did not acknowledge her contributions because she was a woman. She said that he spoke aggressively and that she did not feel safe during meetings with him. When HR asked if there was anything else about Eric that made her feel uncomfortable, Kathy added that perhaps he didn't listen to her ideas because he was sexually attracted to her. And now that she thought more deeply about it, she recalled when he stared at her breasts rather than making eye contact while she was speaking. Further, when asked if there were any witnesses, Kathy said she had been sharing her concerns with coworkers for quite some time. They agreed with her and they would vouch for her. HR confronted Eric. Blindsided, he said he had no idea what Kathy or her friends were at work were talking about, and that he related to her no differently than any other employee. He also said he had not violated any company policies. No one else had ever complained about him during his years with the company, and HR had no tangible evidence to support allegations of sex discrimination. Nevertheless, in order to maintain a safe work environment, promote diversity, and avoid further complications, HR mandated that Eric formally apologize to Kathy and refrain from criticizing her. They also threatened to terminate Eric if he did not comply, informed his manager of what had occurred, and added documentation about the incident to Eric's permanent personnel file. Rumors traveled around the company about Eric's apology and about his disrespect for women. Fearing termination, he no longer voiced an opinion. During the meetings, I retracted his views whenever female co-workers took issue with him. He was eventually passed over for promotion. Kathy was applauded for having the bravery to voice her concerns and stand up for sexual discrimination. She advanced quickly in her career with the company. You may be thinking at this point, is that all it took to destroy Eric's career? As the vignette is derived from real incidents, I assure you that it really can be that easy. While leveraging work-related authorities is key to enabling the damn work method, crafting appropriate workplace allegations and utilizing the correct channels to convey them is required to get those authorities involved. That said, let's review how to tailor the three fundamentals to destroy a man now at work, beginning with allegations. As she goes on to show women how to craft allegations at work, I'm not going to go through it, but you can read it for yourself and on and on. And then how to leverage media. Smear campaigns, channels through companies' internal websites, networks, are one of the most effective media means for destroying a man at work. And in the bottom, so what's required for an effective smear campaign? Well, first you need internal communication networks, or to put it more simply, work friends. You probably already have a network of friends at work. But if you're new to a company, or you tend to be a loner, you'll have to develop one. And she goes on and lists the details, on and on and on, of how to put these methods in place to destroy the man at work. With your network of work friends established, you can begin your smear campaign. Then, leveraging authority. When it comes to the damn at work method, the relationship between authorities affords the greatest leverage. Mainly, the relationship between authorities internal to the company, such as HR, and authorities external to the company, such as the U.S. legal system. And on and on and on and on and on. And there you have it. That's chapter 3 of how to use the damn methods at work.